say definitively that religions are all bullshit.
Hey, man, bro.
Well, you know me, I don't buy it to BS.
I get paid to sign.
I don't fit into human nature.
Do not come here. Do not come marry here.
What the hell was my point?
On getting that intro changed. Yeah, it's gonna be changed eventually.
Has to be updated a little bit.
That's right. We've had a few staff changes. But yeah, welcome to episode 37 of the Brainstorm podcast. Today is December 12th. We're recording live from Festivus for the rest of us. Put on by the Center for Inquiry, Regina. With me tonight, I'm Cory, and with me tonight, I've got Lana, Rene, and Leo. Oh, we got, let's see. Yeah, it's a bit different because we're live on location, so our sound isn't necessarily as good, but...
We're kind of in a closet almost.
Yeah, a little bit of a... It's a tight space. It's warm. But we're having drinks, so it's all good. what else? Anything before we get going here?
No airing of grievances.
No
yet.
No airing of grievances yet. All right, let's get into the Woo report then, I guess.
I'm not a scientist, but if I can tell you your science sucks, then your science really sucks.
That just makes no fucking sense. I mean, it's just bullshit. Fuck.
Yeah. So our first story comes from JacksonianAmerica.com, which is debunking the Lincoln/Kennedy connection. I recently saw a meme on Facebook with a picture of Lincoln and a picture of JFK side by side, and it says, "These are the only two presidents who have ever attempted to end the Federal Reserve banking system. What else do they have in common?" I assume the implication being that they both were assassinated. And this is some very long-running conspiracy to assassinate anybody who tries to get rid of the Federal Reserve. The problem being, of course, that there was no Federal Reserve banking when Lincoln was in office.
Yeah, there wasn't any other reasons why Lincoln would have been shot.
No, of course not. Yeah. There was nobody who disagreed with him at all.
No, none.
Over anything.
But then again, this is one of those ones that have been floating around forever. Like, the... What was it? I think they even said it in the article where they were saying, you know, what was it? The secretaries. JFK had a secretary named Lincoln. And,
oh, yeah. I think Skeptoid also dealt with this whole connection thing at one point where these are kind of coincidences and some of them are flat out fabrications.
Whole heaps and loads of bullshit.
Yeah.
I don't know. Isn't that the way most conspiracy theories work, though?
That is, like, does seem to be the way.
Heaps and loads and tons of bullshit.
here's a coincidence and here's a coincidence and we'll so, connect the two.
Because... So obviously there's a connection and there's some corporate evil mastermind connecting everything together.
Yeah, for sure.
And a lot of these conspiracies, they start off with somebody already having an opinion and they have to look very, very hard to find some sort of link, even if it is just... The secretary had the same name as the other guy's mother or something. And then right. You have, oh, yeah, see, that was for the same reason. But it starts off as already we have this idea and we just need to find a link to claim that it was somehow related.
It's, what do they call it? Jeez. I'm losing the term. It's there's like no, a...
You don't mean confirmation bias, do you?
Well... It is confirmation bias, right? As far as logical fallacies go.
It's kind of begging. What do they call that? Begging the question, or you know, you're starting with the conclusion mm-hmm. and finding points to you know support that, which has got to be some kind of. Oh, okay, yeah.
That's what I was. Sorry to interrupt.
No, it's fine. But yeah, it's a really bad.
But if we're going down
argument.
That road, then why was Reagan shot at? Because I mean. I don't think he was against the banks.
No, I mean, he was just such a good president that he had to be shot. yeah.
Because killing good presidents is where it's at.
Yeah, if they're really, really bad or very, very good, they are at high risk of getting shot. Yes. And that was sarcasm.
Yeah. Well, see, even with the sarcasm, yeah. I'm trying to think why wasn't Bush shot at then?
Yeah.
Because he falls.
He was bad.
Yeah, but I guess not bad enough to be shot at.
Right, right. Yeah, just yeah. not bad enough.
Not bad enough.
But that's saying something about Reagan, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even though what it really was some guy trying to, you know, pick up Jodie Foster and...
Yeah, eh? Yeah, that was an actual reason.
Yeah, that was the actual reason, but...
Yeah. So this site actually has, it has listed... Four good reasons why this is not a thing. There was no Federal Reserve because the Federal Reserve System was established in 1913, which was after Lincoln, obviously. Prior to the Federal Reserve, there had been a national bank, and Andrew Jackson had made its end one of his key second-term goals. Two assassins attempted to kill Jackson, but no evidence suggests that they were sent by the bank. Of course, there's never any evidence that they're doing what they're doing, supposedly.
Well, if there were evidence, I mean, if there was evidence, it wouldn't be a conspiracy. It would
right.
be fact.
It would be fact. Exactly. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And false flags just don't work well when there's facts.
That's right. Yeah. So that was one of our fun ones. I enjoyed that.
But sometimes when I see memes like this one, I just don't have the energy to give it the time of day.
No
it's like,
way.
Oh, why are there so many stupid people out there who that this stuff is actually popular?
Yeah. My problem is that I give people too much credit. So... Then I see this sort of thing and I go, okay, well, if I just present them with something that's factual, I'm sure they'll change their mind, right?
No.
No, that's not how it works, is it?
No.
So if it has to do with the banks that the reason these people get shot, so what exactly did John Lennon and Dimebag Darrell have to do with the banks?
Well, I'm sure Dimebag.
Yeah.
His nickname is clearly bank related.
Well, yeah, this is yeah. Okay, yeah.
Bank roll related anyway.
Yeah.
Okay. I guess we'll move on to getholistichealth.com. Energy efficient bulbs are causing some serious issues. The title reads, "Energy efficient bulbs cause anxiety, migraines, and even cancer." This one's, it's not as easy to, I guess, just dismiss, right? Because there's mercury in those CFL bulbs, and if you don't dispose of a broken one properly, then there's a risk of something.
But I don't see how they're any worse than your standard fluorescent lights. Although
fluorescent bulbs are also included in this.
Oh, okay. The way I read it, I thought it was just aimed at the CFLs. Ones. Yeah. Although I have heard people claim that they get headaches because of fluorescent lights.
Mm-hmm. I know that I find the light irritating compared to other light. I don't know if that is just in my head or if it's just because it's bright, you know, but...
Well, it may be just a wavelength of light that we find irritating. Artificial and irritating.
Yeah.
Because it's not very similar to natural light.
No,
that's there are other types of light that are more similar to candlelight or more similar to natural light.
Because, yeah, fluorescent light tends to be either very white or kind of a weird off yellow.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so there might be something to it, like right. There's that little nugget of truth to it.
I found that this article was particularly, pseudoscientific is what it boils down to. Like, there was three references at the end. The first one is to an article from the Orange County Register titled "Eco-Friendly Bulbs Loaded with Lead and Arsenic." And that article talks about LED bulbs, but the article from Get Holistic Health is talking about CFL bulbs. So there's no supporting information to their article within the reference that they've given.
Which is a pretty good sign that it's bullshit. If you can't, if your references don't support your conclusion.
And even, I mean, it says that apparently these bulbs contain something carcinogenic. But, and that may very well be true, but it's also inside of glass. So... Right. So yeah. The article
which
kind
might
of comes.
To eat it.
Yeah, the article comes off as claiming that the light will give you cancer. Mm-hmm. That
right.
That just having these light bulbs in your house is harmful to you, and I would be willing to bet that if you ate the light bulb, it would be bad for
it
you.
It would be bad. You know, I can grab that.
Yeah, that's yeah.
It.
That's
even if you ignore the fact that eating glass is bad for you, liable to kill you faster than cancer.
That's right.
Yeah, but pretty much any concentrated chemical is bad for you if you just eat it.
Like, yeah. Yeah, just don't eat light bulbs.
Yeah, that's a principle to live by.
Well, so, with the exception of circus sideshow freaks, that's how they make their living. I mean,
right. Yeah. If they've accepted the risk,
it's acceptable risk within the job.
Yeah,
it's kind of part of the job description.
And if that is your job, maybe you should look at this article and look at the potential dangers of eating light bulbs.
Yes, that's fair.
In that context, it might be helpful.
I'm pretty sure the cancer is part of their risk assessment of their lifestyle choices.
The second reference that they've got is from a Natural News article that talks about fluorescent bulbs containing mercury, but it was published in 2011. And it was titled "CF Light Bulbs, a Serious Health Hazard to Women and Children Due to Mercury Content."
So why just women and children?
I don't know.
I think would be mainly for pregnant women and maybe birth defects. That's a question
because
mark.
Because it's such a small amount of mercury that it...
It's more prone to messing maybe with brain development of tiny humans.
Right.
It's along the same lines as why if you're pregnant, you're not supposed to eat sushi, you know, because there some tunas have...
The mercury.
The mercury in it. Yeah,
The mercury is harmful to developing little brains. So if you're female and past childbearing age, then it's not such an issue. Yeah.
Right.
So once again, don't eat the light bulb that has mercury in it.
The Natural News article is talking even about this study. What do we got? I got the article talks specifically about the mercury in the bulbs when they break, but the first story from Get Holistic Health makes a bunch of claims about the symptoms and issues resulting from the bulbs themselves. Where this article is getting its information, it also has another reference to an older article where it almost copied and pasted the article.
Mm-hmm. They're plagiarizing things, being lazy.
And then they provide a link to where they copied and pasted the article from. So the original source was livingtraditionally.com.
So it's like promoting Amishness by telling people that light bulbs are bad, so therefore they should go without such modern conveniences.
Yeah, because these new, these newfangled modern light bulbs, they're dangerous things.
If it's dark outside, you're supposed to be in bed anyway.
That's right. That's right.
The way God and nature intended.
I did manage to track a certain amount of this information down to a Guardian article from 2011 that referenced a study done by Peter Braun from the Berlin Alab Laboratory, but I couldn't find the study, and I couldn't find anything other than the Guardian article that referenced Peter Braun. So
it's probably in German, if it does exist.
If it exists. I wouldn't mind if somebody sent me the link if they could find it, but I have absolutely no idea. So, yeah, that's CF light bulbs. That's that. I guess we'll move on to religious nuttery.
Cornerstone, this might be new to some of you. Scripture says that even our righteous deeds are as filthy rags to God. So even the good things that you do, even things like feeding the hungry and clothing the poor and taking in widows and orphans, as nice as those things are, if not done from the place of obedience to and a relationship with God, are completely worthless and disgusting to God. If you're not daily walking in a place of relationship to God, then the news that we have to bring you is that you're on your way to hell right now.
Yeah, you're going to hell.
Probably.
If there is such a thing. So, this article is from the Friendly Atheist, and it's talking about Joshua Feuerstein. Feuerstein?
I think it's Feuerstein or something.
Feuerstein? Joshua Frankenstein.
Yes.
He says, let's punish Planned Parenthood. Abortion doctors must be afraid for their life. There's an update to this article since I read it last. The clip was from a video that he posted on July 29th about Cecil the Lion. And he lamented about how sad the lion's murder, how people were sad about the lion's murder, but not about the babies, in quotes, who were killed, in quotes, at Planned Parenthood. And, so...
Yeah, I think this. Oh, sorry for interrupting.
No, that's all right.
Yeah, I watched the whole video when it first came out, and it seemed this guy's style is just trying to get a reaction out of people, and I think this was somewhat unfortunate for him because
because of the shooting that came a little while after.
Yeah, because of the shooting. So, in the original video, it's about Cecil the Lion, and he obviously a right-leaning guy who basically has the mentality of, fuck the animals, let's kill them all, they don't really matter. So he gets upset about why are, the outrage about Cecil the Lion, why do people care so much and yet not care about abortion?
Yeah.
But the video did get taken down.
Yeah, that's what Rene was saying earlier. Like, yeah,
the video got taken down right after the shooting.
Yeah,
and he
convenient.
Well, and then he had an updated. He did an updated video.
Oh, did he do an updated video after the, like,
where he said, "I don't want you to actually, literally shoot them. I just want you to use rhetoric suggesting it would be a good idea and that they should fear for their lives."
Yeah,
which is sort of the same point as was. The people that are going around shooting people and planting bombs and things at Planned Parenthood, the point is to scare people out of being involved with that. So
yeah.
And he's promoting that.
I don't know. And it's been pointed out by a million other people, like the irony of it that we're pro-life, but kill that motherfucker.
Right.
Don't kill it. Don't abort the baby. But if they, like George Carlin said, if it grows up to be an abortion doctor, you just might have to kill him.
I mean, one thing that really bothers me about the whole situation is the double standard. So if, let's say, hypothetically, if somebody had made a video like this, let's say even about Cecil the Lion, and just in the end, it had taken a kind of a pro-jihadi twist, you know, kill the Westerners or something, that guy would have been put on the terrorist list,
right?
Like on the watch list, immediately. Mm-hmm. And yet this guy, he continues to be somewhat of a fucked up pastor, you know, who preaches on YouTube.
He has quite the following. Yeah,
yeah. And, mm-hmm. and no repercussions. And the same... The
other
same
than a bunch of other podcasters just rip, just constantly ripping the new asshole.
But that's the thing. Yeah. It does.
It's still PR.
It's still PR, and it doesn't really matter. I mean, we can you know, rip him a new asshole if we want, but it doesn't change the fact that there's still a very big double standard when... You know, this was promoting a hate crime. I mean, though he claims it wasn't
promoting it kind of a terrorism.
It was terrorism because it was a politically motivated act of senseless killing. That's the definition of terrorism.
Yep.
And he was outright explicitly saying, you know, these people need to run for their lives. Now, I think nobody should say that, you know, in any situation.
Yeah, I agree.
But just the fact that there's this double standard of this person can say it, this person cannot. And there's different repercussions if they do.
Yeah, I don't know. Initially that makes perfect sense. Initially, that wasn't my reaction. I always go right to the whole facts, right? Like, he's talking about babies being murdered, and I just go, that's not what that fucking is, dude. Like, that's not babies. These are not things.
But in
like,
their view, in their, in it
their,
is.
Yeah, in their point of view is, you know, like, I think we've talked about it before, where there's some really right-leaning politicians that are wanting to redefine conception.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
They want to make it, you know, like.
But that's to me, that's they want to change facts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I mean, to do that.
I'm pretty sure they want to change it to the fact if you jerk off, that's pretty much abortion.
I've heard that before. I've heard that before.
And there are some religions that take it that far, that jacking off is like killing babies. Yeah. I mean, as far as like moral sins.
It's going to be really interesting to see what kind of, if there is any blowback to the fact that Canada has just approved abortion pills. And like it, it's the equivalent to the RU, whatever it is in the States, that Europe's had for like decades. It's just been approved in Canada. So if you think that a 50 day old embryo or whatever the heck it is at that stage is equivalent to a 10-year-old, then you think that that is murder and that this is a horrible thing. That will now be available at your local pharmacy.
In a pill. Murder in a pill?
Yeah.
Great. So. Now I got Monty Python in my head. Sacred.
Yeah.
The funny thing is I've had that conversation because like when that video came up about Planned Parenthood and sewing baby parts and whatever else, which turned out to be total bullshit.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm. right. Totally fabricated.
I was having this discussion with someone, and it, you know, I was saying how I was bullshit, and they're just okay. Yeah, but then the conversation turned so that it was like, you know, well, you know, abortion. Well, if you're just using it as retroactive birth control, that's not right. And I'm like, that's not necessarily what it is. Like,
and what makes that wrong?
Yeah, it's not. Well, that's not. Like, people are dumb. Do we want dumb people necessarily babies because they forgot, they got drunk, and they got knocked up? Yeah. Is that a good reason to make people have babies?
Well, mind you, I blamed it on his Catholic upbringing. But I just said, yeah, that's your Catholic upbringing. Coming, oh, maybe. But that's just it. There is that attitude of, you know, I don't know. This whole idea of, oh, it's sacred life. Well, no, because then you go into the definitions, and yes, there's that whole thing of there is a point where late term abortions, maybe the fetus
has some rights that has to be protected.
Yeah, you know, point of no return kind of thing.
Yeah,
you know,
where point of viable. No return. Yeah. But even still, at that point, if the woman carrying that fetus says, I ain't going to be pregnant anymore, and they induce her, and it's early, and whatever. I don't think you can force a woman necessarily to carry that viable fetus.
To stay pregnant.
To stay pregnant.
No. Well, yeah, no, yeah.
But they can get unpregnant pretty darn fast.
Yeah.
And then they don't have any particular obligation to care for that child. Like, this, they can hand that child over to the state, and the state can... So, you know, it's not as though we're obligated to look after the products of our conception for 18 years. You're not. You could turn it over to the state. Anyone can look after that baby.
I mean, but these are all arguments that these people don't want to hear.
No, that's true. That's true. They're not listening to us saying, oh, well, on second thought, maybe they have a point.
Here's the reality is, you know, like, abortions happen for a multitude of reasons. Yeah. You know, all they want to know.
Some good reasons, some bad reasons. Yeah. But do you really want to be the arbitrator on everybody's individual reasons?
I mean, the thing is that there's a reason why we have church and state separation. It is so that we don't make laws based on your moral code. Mm-hmm. And so that is very important because everybody has a different moral code. Like, even the four of us, we would have different things where we draw the line on different issues. You know, this is not right. And the next person would be fine with it. And that's why it's so important to keep a clear line between those two. Now, it could be your opinion that something is wrong, but that doesn't mean that if the majority agrees that this is immoral, that it should be against the law. Because if that were true, then potentially you could outlaw drinking or smoking,
right?
Which was a thing for a little while.
I think what you have to remember is that it's pro-choice doesn't necessarily mean pro-abortion.
Yeah. No. Right.
You should have the choice.
Yeah.
You know.
Because everybody is going to draw that line at their own discretion.
But the first thing that comes up with any anti-abortion person, it's always a moral argument. And that's the thing. The law is not the ultimate moral code,
right?
Per se. It is for a well-functioning society. What do we need to do to ensure that our society will function well?
And it protects individual rights.
Yeah.
And balances individual rights, but it's not necessarily a moral arbiter.
Yeah.
So basically, this guy's an asshole.
We overrated
absolutely,
asshole.
Absolutely. Yeah. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, but yeah. He gets on serious nude shows just because he's a famous YouTuber and they want to have, you know, it's clickbait for TV, clickbait for all, you know.
And then he has
to be ignored.
And then reasonable people have to talk to him
and say why national television. He's wrong.
And he just shouts over them and like
exactly.
And then
it's just for ratings.
It's the
so
worst.
It's
the absolute worst.
He's Fred Durst with a fucking Bible.
Yeah, that's right. All right. That's about 30 minutes. We're going to jump into a commercial break for a few things and then come back for some Skepticism 101.
If you like the Brainstorm podcast and want to get more of it, you can go to patreon.com/brainstormpodcast for bonus material, early ad-free episodes, and a shout-out in the next episode. Special Brainstorm gear bonuses for different Patreon levels are available. You can get your own Brainstorm shirts, mugs, and lots more from cafepress.ca/brainstormpodcastgear. Thanks for your support.
We are given one life, full of billions of small and large decisions. To be somebody, to change, to be kind, to give hope, to become a better person, and to leave a lasting impact on this planet. It is a decision to be made every single day while your heart is still beating. We've made our decision. Absence of clothing. Atheist and science-based apparel and merchandise. Donating 50% of our profits to charity. Look good and feel good without God. Check us out at absenceofclothing.com and find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Pinterest for discount codes and other sweet swag.
Use the code BRAINSTORM at absenceofclothing.com and get 10% off.
Hi, this is Trev Mamone of the By Any Means Podcast. The By Any Means Podcast is a weekly show where I interview guests about the intersections of social justice and humanism. Just go to www.byanymeans.com, that's by spelled B-I, to hear the podcast and read the blog. Because, hey, aren't we all a little bi-curious?
Okay, and we're back, and we've got a mess all of a sudden. Cracked up one of these beers that we got from the Festivus events, and yeah, made a big mess.
Corey's cut off just by opening the beer.
Jeez, I reek like ale aged in an oak bourbon barrel.
Yeah,
so... All right, so we're back, and we'll do Skepticism 101. So I guess we've covered logical fallacies. We've covered a little bit about the brain and cognitive biases. And this one I wanted to just cover a little bit about fact-checking and how we do it and why we do it. Because as if that's not obvious to us, I guess. But so first off, I guess when you're reading a story, what's the first thing that you do when you read something on the internet?
Looking at me.
First thing I do is I check to see what website it is and then go, is this full of shit?
Well, the first thing that I think everybody does so without knowing it is we all have a built-in bullshit detector.
Yeah.
I mean, we have something. When we read something, we immediately see, oh, this seems implausible, or mm-hmm. or we have, oh, this could very well be true. And then we measure the importance of it. If we see something that really sticks out and triggers our bullshit detector, then it needs to be looked into.
Right.
Yeah. What often, you know, I'm pretty good at not falling for the hoax sites. But once in a while I do, but, you know... So I'll read something. If it sounds really goofy or too good to be true, then I usually will Google the site to make sure that it's not a hoax site. But there's this CBC this or that that's gotten me before on things. And, you know, it's usually something I wish was true, but unfortunately wasn't. That some, you know, there's bullshit quote or something that was just too good to be true.
Or something that seems like, okay, of course everybody's like that, or, yeah, you know, this is obviously a thing, but
yeah. So I like, hopefully, you know, when people who are sort of savvy at evaluating information, you know, they have these skills of saying, okay, this is a well-sourced article. It refers to either, it refers to research, it refers to statistics, or it refers to specific quotes from specific people.
Right.
It's not just a bunch of wild conjecture and unsourced rigmarole.
Right.
But unfortunately, many, many people aren't really schooled in being able to distinguish, you know, this is a bullshit blog versus this is a, you know, an article. And then, you know, even within that, you recognize that there's certain media outlets have a certain slant. So you understand that something's coming through a certain lens or a filter.
Yeah.
But it doesn't necessarily mean their information is wrong. It may just be coming from kind of a biased
The way they're presenting slant. It might be, yeah.
It might be a bit of a biased presentation.
And I think another thing is so many people just don't care enough. Because nowadays, in the age of information, we get so much information about everything, every day, just dumped on us. And a lot of people don't really care about the sources. I guess they truly do care if it's true or not, but they don't care enough to actually investigate.
Right.
So if somebody comes up to you and tells you that this just happened, a lot of people just tend to take it at face value. Just like, oh, interesting. If it doesn't sound like too far-fetched, like, oh, yeah, all right, that sounds good. And that's a big problem because everybody does it. And then they go and tell their neighbor, you know, I just heard this just happened. And then it just keeps perpetuating. And that with the article that I was talking about before at the dinner table, the drug cartel fighting ISIS.
Right.
Yeah.
And the Fox article had already gotten like over 250,000 shares.
Right.
Yeah. So 250,000 people did not do a simple Google search to see if it was true and just simply shared it.
Yeah.
Just taking it at face value, saying, oh, this seems interesting. I should share this with my friends. And so that's a big problem where people don't care enough to research something or even look into it slightly before sharing it.
It fits their worldview already.
Yeah. I sometimes wonder if it's kind of like a hangover from – it used to be before the age of the internet, I want to see what's going on. So we turn on the news and you trust the news. Mm-hmm. And there's kind of a hangover from that where it's like, well, it's
– if it's on the news, I won't question it.
If it's on the news, I don't question it. If it's on the internet, which is kind of like the news, I don't question it.
It's a very sad commentary that news sites that are seen as legitimate sources of information by vast source types, of, you know, like they are mainstream news outlets, that because there's so much seeking after clickbait, because they are so much commercial driven, they will put on these things that they suspect or they know are not true just to get the clicks, and then they'll put in a little, oh, actually, it turns out this isn't true thing later. Nobody really cares. It's not like they get a big black eye for posting a bullshit story.
No, but it's still a carryover of if it bleeds, it leads.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's still lots of that. Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So and that's one of the reasons that people are going away from from watching the mainstream.
Right.
I don't want to say mainstream media because that's a stupid word or phrase, but from. You know, from cable news sources, basically.
Right.
Which unfortunately is creating the rise legitimate. Of Infowars.com.
Yeah, which is also a problem, right? Because, like you say, these secondary, media. These alternative media sources, they're like, they don't have to fact check either.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They just promote whatever they want and call it the truth.
Although Young Turks are very good. I like Young Turks.
Yes, I like the Young Turks. They're usually quite good.
There are a lot of news sites, like you said, and I have a lot of friends who are very, very far left, who think that only alternative news sites should be read. But looking into alternative news sites, they are, I would go out on a limb and say they are more biased than mainstream media, than the cable news like CNN. Though CNN is mostly bullshit because that's very dry news. But the alternative ones, they pretty much all of them have some kind of political agenda.
Well, there's no such thing as just straight news, right? Yeah. It's all editorialized.
Not anymore.
Yeah.
There really isn't anymore.
No. Especially
other than Associated Press. Like, if you see something that's quoted Associated Press or something where it's just straight up news story from some reporter, but it's the editorializing of, you know, this is what happened, and we're going to explain why this matters to you. It's the people explaining why this should matter to you that makes a difference.
It seems to be the more Americanized, because like you can, like BBC, you can trust.
That's true. They're generally
more.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
You know,
though BBC, well, I think BBC, CNN, they are both rated fairly high with not being biased in their reporting. But where they are biased is what they report.
Right.
So the thing is, let's say recently there have been several like mass shootings and bombings all over Africa. That doesn't get reported. And when something happens in California, CNN has run a whole fucking week of nothing but that.
Yeah, that's
and
true.
And so what they present is pretty factual. I mean, CNN is recognized as being very non-biased. Well, it was. Now, most recently, it's kind of.
Yeah, it's less.
But they're still fairly they're still fairly good at what they do. But what they report is very biased and selective because they have to pay the bills. Mm-hmm. People, they want the clickbait. They wanna read stuff that happened close to them, mm-hmm. and that causes a big uproar.
Depending on your region, like they say, like CNN.
It's going to have an American bias because Americans, they love their, they don't give two shits outside of their own.
No.
Quite often, yeah.
And Al Jazeera is, I have my issues with Al Jazeera. It is funded by the wrong people. It is owned by the wrong people. But they do, I must admit, they do a pretty good job of spreading out all over the world.
Right.
And
they do some good reporting on a lot of things. They have some good reporters. They've got a bit of a slant, but they've got some good reporters.
And just the fact that they will actually report the weather for South Africa or something, which seems insignificant, but it is important in the grand scheme of things.
When you're reporting world news to the world, it matters.
Yeah. It's not all about, well, is it snowing in New York City today?
Right.
And so
for sure.
For that reason, I kind of like them from the,
But once again, it's that thing of like CNN's American bias always kicks in because they know Americans don't give a shit what the weather is like in South Africa. Yeah. They don't care. You know, it's like plane crashes today. You know, 300 killed. No Americans. I don't care.
Like, you got to look at where your clicks are coming from, I guess, right? Yeah.
I mean,
but that's the difference. I mean, Al Jazeera has less of a problem of how to pay the bills.
Right.
I mean, they have the money situation kind of.
They're not relying on ad clicks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that gives them the advantage of not having to pander to people, but they still do.
Right.
So
well, it's like that meme that went around where it's like, you know, it shows if Obama, they show a picture of Obama drinking Pepsi, you know, how CNN covers it, you know, and then how Fox covers it, and then how BBC covers it. It's like, you know, I can't remember the exact meme, but it was something along the lines of Pepsi stocks go down 10%. You know, look at how un-American, you know, Obama is because he's drinking Pepsi instead of Coke. And then BBC, where it's like, and, you know, 23 people died in a typhoon and, you know, some other else. Like, they don't give two shits.
Yeah, it's not always about Obama, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I guess we kind of streamed off there, but just as what I do when I read an article is quite often, depending on what the content is, I'll scroll to the bottom because you're always looking for sources, right? Mm. So especially when it's a science-based article, mm-hmm. you need sources. So those sources will almost always tell you whether or not you can trust this article or not.
Mm-hmm. And I guess to add to that, one very helpful tip that I would give anybody listening, it is just entering the article title in form of a question into Google and Googling
debunk whatever.
Yeah.
It is very helpful if it says light bulbs cause cancer. Do light bulbs cause cancer? And hit enter. And more often than not, you will, if it is true, you will find several other articles that'll pop up that will corroborate this one, mm-hmm. which is a good sign. And if the first five searches of that query are hoax, 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 hoax,
right.
that's a bad sign.
Yeah.
So that's a very simple thing that you can do that will have a pretty accurate. And this is not to say that determines if it's true or not.
Right.
But it's a very good first step to kind of, I see where this is going.
Actually, looking into it is a good. Don't trust the first article you read. Yeah. There's a lot of good websites out there too, like Snopes, mentioned. Hoax Slayer.
I love Snopes. I have for years.
PolitiFact is pretty good. There's times that I'm like, you know, I think they are too hard on some of the left-wing people. Just, you know, they'll rate something that's mostly true as, you know, mostly not true.
In an attempt to seem balanced.
In an attempt to seem more balanced, because the stuff that the right wing is doing is so out to lunch that, you know, they...
because facts have a liberal bias.
Yeah.
And, that's, you know, that works.
Yeah,
and, and it sounds like we're just making, you know, excuses or whatever why things are as balanced as they are. But like, there are definitely times where I go, come on, this is nonsense.
Half true. That's actually true.
It is true. It's just, you know, on a technicality, if you really want to press a point, it may not be completely literally true, but it, you know, it's 95% true on the gist of the thing.
Yeah.
And it's important to not take anything as objective fact. I mean, there are so many websites, and the good thing is to get a broad scope and then kind of synthesize. So what are all these sites, all these news outlets saying about this one thing? And then kind of get a, because if you take one article's word for it, I mean, that is always dangerous. If you declare that to be the objective. Yeah.
And I've had this conversation with like family member that's like, oh, you can't just read CBC. You have to, you know, you've got such a liberal bias and you have to read other sources of information. And I'm like, you know, my eyes are rolling back in my head. I'm like, you know, evaluate all kinds of information. So if I read something in the Globe and Mail that says, you know, Harper's an idiot, then, you know, I give that a little bit of more weight than if it's just some liberal blog that's saying Harper did this, this, and this, and this. So I will go and intentionally look for right-wing sources that are basically admitting one of their favorite, you know, little hobby horses has the wheels have fallen off of it or whatever. You know, you look for those things that, or where some right-wing thing will say, yes, climate change is real, or, you know, so that you can say, look, we've got all kinds of different sources saying the same thing. That has
never been done, ever.
Has that been a thing?
No, there was some, never mind, there was something lately where there was somebody saying that, you know, confirming that climate change was a thing that was sort of coming from an unexpected source, but I forget what it was now. So it's
I have actually seen a couple, like you say, unexpected sources that go, oh, well, climate change is a real thing. And then they continue in the article to kind of, I don't know, almost wash it
backpedal
out.
But
it's the initial headline is like, oh, wow, okay. Mm-hmm. Maybe they've got their shit together.
Oh, I think one of them
bit.
Was Exxon. Okay. We're getting kind of off in the weeds, but one of them was like Exxon saying, well, if, you know, if we keep going the way it does and government doesn't change what it's doing, then climate change will end up being like 7 to 10 or 18 degrees of change. And, and you know, so if that's what Exxon is saying, well, maybe we should take that seriously. But that it wasn't something where I'd spent a lot of time looking into whether Exxon actually had published that.
Right.
But it's also something I didn't retweet and try to, you know, blow up and spread around because I haven't confirmed if Exxon was actually saying that climate change is a real thing.
Right. So persons, like, quite often we're quite careful about what we reshare or what we
be careful.
Start promoting because you don't always know what the background is. And
one of the ones that I've seen a bunch this Christmas, and since it's almost Christmas, we might as well, I can mention this one. There was a bullshit meme graphic going around saying that a bunch of the charities were like wasting all kinds of money and had Rolls Royces and had ridiculously high salaries. Remember, remember that one? It's like so and so charity has a corporate Rolls Royce.
Well, it wasn't quite that specific, but it was the one I'm thinking of. Is it had a chart of how much donated dollars and how much per dollar gets used.
There was one going around, a graphic going around that actually listed Snopes as a source for the article, but if you went and looked up the Snopes article on this, it was debunking all of the information that this graphic was proposing was true.
So the epitome of cherry picking.
Crazy cherry picking.
When you're referencing Snopes to make an argument, and a serious argument, then you should be questioned.
Well, if you're using the thing that Snopes debunked.
To prove
that it's true and referencing Snopes to as your background.
It's a backwards kind of reference.
They didn't read the whole article.
It was just some kind of goofy shit. where they were trying to say United Way was a horrible charity that wasted a whole bunch of money. And whenever I saw this, I was like, this is not true. This is the link to the Snopes article. It's based on a whole lot of bullshit and some very outdated information and, you know, stuff that's manufactured whole cloth.
Right.
So this is one of those good examples of don't assume that if you see some little graphic about your favorite charity saying that it's horrible, well, don't assume that that's true, because somebody could just be being malicious. Somebody could just be trying to tear down people that are doing good work just to be in it. Dick.
Yeah, that's right.
I recently had an experience with a friend of mine who just pretty much 90% of his posts are bullshit. They're mostly memes or like blog posts that are just, you know, you can see right off the bat that this is not true. And I tend to be a nice guy, so I wrote him an inbox message, you know. I've seen some interesting articles you've posted. A lot of them are somewhat incorrect. I think it might be a good idea to if you fact check them before posting them.
Right.
And I was being as nice as I could possibly be. And so, but I got a message back. It was, you fucking idiot. You know, just because you're a liberal and disagree with my opinions doesn't mean they're false.
Ugh.
And then I was like, you know, okay, wait. It has nothing to do with my opinion. I mean, you know, just look into this. Like, this is objectively false. Like, these numbers that you've posted are, like, you can look them up and they are false. That's just not true.
Yeah.
And I got so many angry messages back just condemning me for being a liberal
and your terrible liberal hippie gay worldview.
I got.
Did you get called a libtard?
What was the word? It was.
Once I get called a libtard, I just, all right, fuck you then. I'm done.
It was a lib something, but it wasn't tard. It was
okay.
But it was it was the same idea.
Same idea.
But yeah. So in the end, we didn't get anywhere with that conversation.
No.
He ended up calling Mexico socialist, which is just absolutely not true. Which is, I mean, Mexico is about as capitalistic as the U.S.
Yeah.
Maybe even more so. But so at that point, I'm like, and then he made an argument based on that. See, Mexico is socialist. Mexico's not doing that well. They have a lot of violence. And I'm like, well, look into some, Google most socialist countries in the world and see how they're doing.
Yeah.
Because you'll get Northern European countries mostly.
Yeah, the Scandinavian ones are...
Yeah,
generally doing okay. Pretty socially. Yeah.
Yeah, very socialist and doing okay.
Yeah,
yeah. Fact checking, it's a thing.
Yeah,
not a well known thing, but it is.
They should teach it in school. Yeah. I don't know how much they do right now.
And I think every college student should be forced to take critical thinking, like 100. Right. Yeah. I mean, I think that should be a core requirement for every college graduate.
It should
and
be.
How to evaluate absolutely. Sources, how to sort through bullshit on the internet.
And that's just the very basic. Like, just what are some of the key indicators that you look at when checking how factual something is?
And this, because this is a tool that you need in your everyday life.
Yeah.
This is not just
didn't used to be as much because you had encyclopedias, you had, you know, at the supper news hour, there was no 24-hour cable news. There was like the supper news hour and newspapers. And that was where people got their information.
Yeah, that's right. Who was I listening to? I was listening to a podcast and the guest, it was Armin Navabi, actually. We had him on our show. And he was saying that it's the age of information, but it's also the age of misinformation.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just so much out there that you absolutely have to learn how to fact check everything that you read.
And ignorance is in a way better than misinformation, because most people don't act on their ignorance, but they act on their misinformation.
Right.
And so that's where it can become dangerous. And I guess, like, tying this into one of the arguments that I was having with this previously mentioned guy on Facebook was about refugee stats.
Oh, yeah.
And so what drove me over the edge was an article, you know, where they just flat out lied about that. And I called him out, you know, that specific article you know, you can look up the numbers and that's just not true.
Right.
Because they're and that's where it becomes dangerous, because if you have people misinformed, they can potentially go out and hurt people or instigate violence or abuse towards
they're acting on that wrong information.
Because it's somewhat justified. I mean, that's the violence. If you sincerely believe that somebody wearing a kneecap is objectively a threat, like if that were true, then you might be just, but it's not. And so if you are misinformed on the issue,
right,
then
that is a danger to society.
And you may have the best of intentions because you truly believe that a person of this, who looks in a certain way is dangerous. If you think that, you know, Mexicans are dangerous.
Or black men are dangerous.
And right. If you truly...
Well, after name your Islamic issue, how many Sikhs have been...
Yeah, exactly. Attacked.
Well, yeah, and now it's a daily thing. Violence against people who even just look like they might be Muslim in the U.S.
If you go around wearing a headscarf, and you know whether you're Muslim or not, you might get in a lot of trouble.
And that's where it's important to understand that it's with the best of intentions for a lot of people. I mean, if you legitimately think that this person is a threat to me and my family, then you have good intentions with very bad information. And so that's where misinformation is very, very dangerous, not only to you, but to people around you.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. I think we played that out.
Yep.
I don't know if we got to the point, but we played it out.
I think we did.
I think we did. Okay, I think we got some good stuff.
Well, sum up the point as... Double check your
shit.
That should be a segment name.
Before you repost it.
No. Fact check your shit.
All right. So we actually have a new bumper for Atheism for Dummies. So we'll go with that. I'd also like to tell you about...
If you're not walking in a place of relationship to God, then the news that we have to bring you is that you're on your way to hell right now.
Oh, you're barking up the wrong tree, Meg. I'm an atheist.
I suspect that the Pope is an atheist.
I don't believe in God.
Right, so that's our new Atheism for Dummies bumper.
Other bumpers mixed in.
Yeah, well, part of that one is the Christ Core scene. We've covered what atheism was and why there's an atheist movement. We've covered a few terms that are associated with atheists and atheism. We've covered what apologetics were, although we will specify that closer, like we'll actually target some apologetic arguments eventually. And we've asked what other things atheism says about us as people. But today I want to just discuss a little bit about the history of atheism. Because there have been atheists throughout history that, while theism has been the mainstay in most cases, there's been a few different segments of society that didn't believe in God. This is all pretty much from the History of Atheism wiki page. But Eastern regions... religions, Buddhism, Jainism, and some Hinduism, and Taoism, which all have some non-deity-based philosophy, and that actually dates back to 6th century BCE, when they were but they still had like things like the soul and eternal life, even though they didn't necessarily have a god.
Well, the Eastern religions, do a lot of ancestor worship, but not necessarily...
Ancestor and reincarnation type.
Mm-hmm. Less so than, like, God or gods, right?
That the spirit lives on in the trees or in your ancestors or your kids or dogs or, you know, that... a weird mixture of all of that.
In a lot of ways, I find it less objectionable. Not necessarily more true, but less objectionable. Unless it's a less actionable kind of a belief.
Seems like, yeah.
I think the difference is what little I know of Eastern religions or as I said, I think it was the last podcast, I called them philosophies, and Mike, you know.
Yeah, he chimed in on the chat.
Yeah, some snide comments through the chat. But there's the difference between them, not necessarily atheism per se, but their focus is different, is that it's about themselves, like the religions, the philosophies, or whatever. Mm. It's about themselves, whereas Western ones, it's they give it all over to this higher deity.
Yeah,
you know. So
and you lose control of yourself, or are supposed to give up control of yourself and be, you know, the
a supplicant. Yeah,
yeah, and be, you know, be under someone else's control.
And I think that's one of the things that a lot of ex-Christians have issue with, you know, the fact that you are asked to give up your personal autonomy,
right,
to a deity where you can't masturbate, you're not supposed to consume, yeah, certain things, you're not supposed to do certain things. And it's not about wanting to be rebellious and like, oh well, look, I'm going to show this deity, but it's about, you know, why is a person not important? I mean, if the soul is God's soul, and then the person is not that important.
Yeah. Eh?
And you're supposed to surrender everything to some higher power.
Yeah. Yeah, I think there was, I mean, it's been a while since I read it, but I read something about, there's a quote in Buddhism. It's about, if you see the Buddha on the road, then kill it. Or if you see the Buddha outside of you, then kill it, because Buddha is supposed to be you. It's not supposed to be something outside of you.
And I think with all the, considering all religions, I think Buddhism is the one that I have the least issue with, I would say. It is still a little bit too much bullshit for me, but they take a very kind of a chill approach to a lot of things, like, you know.
Mostly.
Yeah, meditate.
You know. No, the vast majority are very peaceful and, yeah, not pushy.
Yeah.
There's a, you know, it's a very small fringe that is not particularly safe.
Yeah. Yeah, there is, we talked about it last podcast, actually. There was a group in a country, I can't remember.
Burma?
Yeah, maybe.
Myanmar.
Myanmar.
Myanmar?
Well, it used to be
same,
Burma.
Same, oh, okay, thing.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and they kind of took these dogmatic views of Buddhism, and
but once again, it's a little different because they're in control,
right?
You know, yeah, they are the
quite often when you have a political control,
yeah, it changes it.
And it's, yeah, and it's that's a good example of it. It's dangerous to mix politics with religion, because if, mm-hmm, politics is very dangerous in itself, because you have political motives for justifying horrible actions,
yeah,
and if you mix in religious arguments, you have yet another justification.
God's on your side all, yeah, of a sudden.
So then you have two justifications, yeah, for what you're doing, because, right,
like killing abortion doctors,
exactly,
yeah,
or, right, or just random people at an abortion clinic. Yeah, you're not necessarily killing.
Though they have no political backing for their for killing the doctors, because it is legal, and killing is illegal. There, mm-hmm, I would say it's religious and trying to make a political statement.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Kind of sidestep the history of
these. Yeah. So, I mean, so yeah, we kind of moved off from the, but there's also lots of, religious critics in Greek philosophy. There was, like Epicurus is a pretty famous one. I'm not sure how to pronounce this entirely, but, Xenophanes. Sure. Famously said that if cows and horses had hands, then horses would draw the forms of gods that looked like horses and cows. So, yeah.
That's an interesting quote.
Yeah. And Anna Zor... fuck. Somebody from 5th century BC claimed that the sun was a fiery mass larger than the Peloponnese, and a charge of impiety was brought against him. Epicurus had a very materialistic philosophy. There's, yeah. Socrates was ancient Greek. there's lots of great philosophy that was not particularly deity-based from ancient Greece. Although there's some that was that did have its roots in theology or theism, I guess it would be. Then we've got the Middle Ages, but apparently Europe was pretty religious in the Middle Ages.
Yeah.
Very, very much so.
The best religious critics, the best atheists and rationalists were from Islamic areas in the Middle Ages.
Well, actually, a lot of the Islamics, they're what kept the Greek philosophies. They mm-hmm. collected
right,
them.
Eh?
And that they kept, where they're, when the Renaissance happened, that's where they got the information from.
Yeah. We actually owe a lot to Islam in that regard. There used to be a time where they were the keepers of information,
right.
pretty much, because
and
when
math.
When yeah when the yeah. church went through the dark ages, yeah. Islam was
beacon of light.
They were a beacon of light.
They had knowledge.
They were the ones who had the scientists and the philosophers dealing with complex issues and writing things down and compiling
and
books
algebra.
And yeah,
right.
Which is, I think, an Arabic word.
I believe so.
Yeah.
Algebra.
Could be.
We should fact check that.
We should fact check that. I am.
You guys have Google phones.
I am admitting ignorance as to the fact of the origin of the word algebra. So let's see. I'm not even going to try and, like, I want to try and say this name, but I'm going to ruin it.
There?
Al Rawandi.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. He criticized the notion of, or she? It doesn't say the gender of the person who spoke
yet.
It. They criticized the notion of religious prophecy, including that of Muhammad, and maintained that religious dogmas were not acceptable to reason and must be rejected. There's lots of critics of religion in the Islamic world, including physician and philosopher Abu Bakr al-Razi. Did you look up algebra?
I did.
You look like you looked up
algebra.
Am
I right?
You are.
I'm right.
From the Arabic al-jabra, which A-L-J-A-B-R, meaning reunion of broken parts.
Cool.
Okay.
So back to the...
That's a little factoid for you.
Points for Lana.
Fantastic. Yep. Points Yay. For Lana. Brainstorm points.
Yay.
I don't think they're worth anything.
They might someday. They might someday.
Okay. So I guess that's just a very brief start to the history of atheists. I think we'll move on to apologetics next time. But I wanted to kind of recognize that atheism isn't a new thing. Like,
it's just become more safe to be openly atheist.
And the thing is, I mean, the religions we see nowadays are not like they used to be, like a lot of them. So there has always been a skeptical portion of, you know, I mean, you even if it is just reforming from one religion to an like to a reformed version of that same religion, but there is still skeptical thinking within religions where certain things just get dropped from the official creed. There have always been critical thinkers within the religions as well, and they just don't go far enough.
Right, they just don't take it that extra step.
Eh? Yeah, that extra step.
Yeah. No, there's actually a pretty full history of philosophical thinkers and just even like flat-out hardcore atheists like in the last 100 years, say. Like even just like Madeline Murray O'Hare wasn't that long ago, and she's a major figure in atheism as a movement or secularism as a movement. And I think that that's the kind of thing that needs to be at least be recognized. This isn't a new thing. So, I guess with that said, we can do our music break. We're going to enjoy some Stone Temple Pilots songs because Scott Whelan passed away. And for me, this is a big deal because I grew up in the 90s. So we've got Down from the album Number 4, Naked Sunday and Wicked Garden from the album Core.
We'll be right back.
All right, we're back. We're missing a couple of our cast members, but I think they're drinking, so it's all good. We're still live at Festivus at, for the rest of us from CFI Regina. Oh, Leo's coming back in. with us, we're going to kind of have an open door policy here with guests from the Festivus coming in and answering a few questions and chatting a bit. Right now we got Dan. I don't know if you want your last name public.
Yeah, let's just stick with Dan for now.
Okay, sounds good, Dan. So, I guess, hey, nice, I'm drinking the wine.
Classy.
Right out of the bottle.
Yeah, so I guess we'll say, Dan, how long have you been involved with the CFI?
I was in pretty well right since the beginning in Regina. Actually, it was kind of funny. Let's say maybe 7 or 8 years ago, I was looking online in Regina for a group that was for people who didn't have a religion, because it was right around then that I was kind of discovering what I believed and what I didn't believe. And I found that there was really no groups in Regina for it. And my first instinct was, I got to start that. And then immediately after, I was like, I would be an idiot to start that by myself, because it's just, I felt like there'd be so little support for it. So instead I said, you know what? If somebody else wants to spearhead this and start this, I'm just going to put my name on a list. So on meetup.com, I just put my name on a list and said, look, if a group in my area ever starts up and they put a tagline or a tag of atheism, skepticism, free thinking, agnosticism, anything like that, I'm like, you know what? I'll join it. I'm just not going to be the one that starts it. I just want to start attending a group like that. So that's all that I did. And then a couple of years later, I got an email, and thankfully it didn't just go into my spam or something, because it actually came, and I said, geez, that looks like it would be fun. So I joined, and they'd actually had a couple meetups already.
That's awesome. I had kind of a similar experience. Like, being from Weyburn, it was a little different. I actually found the Saskatoon group, and then after I was part of that for a little while, then I found the Regina group, and that's super cool.
Yeah, we're a little bit closer than that. I remember seeing their group and thinking the same thing. Well, I really want something in my city.
Yeah.
But I just wasn't willing to bite the bullet and be the guy who went and started it up, because I just, some people are leaders and some people are followers. And now that I am technically the branch president right now, it was almost thrust upon me. I don't want to. So if any of our listeners are looking to take over that, just shoot me a message or let the Brainstorm guys know.
It's probably a good idea to be a resident of the Regina area, though.
Yeah, that would help. That would certainly help.
Yeah, so, I mean, you're an atheist.
Yes, sir.
How long have you been an atheist?
I don't know. So like around 15, so that was right around high school. I was actually, my first Christian ethics class, I tried to volunteer as a lector in my parish, because that's what I had did actually in my grade 8 year. And so I was like, okay, might as well just go do that again. And I was sitting there at the front one time, and I was literally nodding off. So my head, I was doing the leg jerk thing and everything as I was at the front. And I was just, one time I snapped awake, and I was like, okay, now I'm really going to stay awake. And I'm sitting up there, and as I was listening to the priest chant, and the people stand up, and the people sit down, and the people stand up and sit down, and just something clicked in my head, and I was like, I am in a cult. I'm like, I have to get out. And that's kind of when it dawned on me. And, you know, it took me a while to sort of admit to my parents and admit to everybody else, because I was just really scared of what everyone was going to say, because I thought everyone believes in God. I went to a school where everybody did, and we were taught that it was right.
Right.
So it was just very worrisome for me. But then when I said it to my dad, he was just like, oh, okay.
Really?
Yeah. Yes. And it was just really a non-issue. And then I found out my mom was very like, a weak religious, and now she calls herself agnostic. So
is that right?
Yeah.
Your parents were here tonight.
Yeah, my mom and her now husband were here, and both of them are atheists, even though my mom teaches in she calls herself agnostic, but I say, look, get off the fence. If someone points someone points a gun at your head, I remember hearing you guys had this discussion before about agnosticism and versus atheism. You're answering a different question, and that's what I try to tell her. But I said, if someone put a gun to your head and said, do you believe, it's the belief that I'm asking, not about the knowledge. So anyways, yeah, she's an atheist, but she just wants to sit on the fence.
That's fine too, I guess.
I guess agnosticism is a bit of a a softer term. It's something that doesn't have the same stigma to it as right. atheist does.
Yeah, well, considering she teaches in the separate system, I think it would be better for herself to, yeah. to call herself an agnostic. That'd be easier to get away from than a yeah. full-blown atheist, right?
And I think even a good way to put it, if the people around you are very sensitive to the word, I mean, just a secular humanist, I mean, that is yet another term, but it also, in essence, has kind of the same...
Yeah, connotation yeah. almost. Yeah.
Yeah.
But sometimes people, that word sounds a little bit, you know, university-ish. They don't really know what it means.
And, true.
Yeah, so sometimes yeah. when you say that, they're just like, oh, yeah, okay. And they don't. They just yeah. slough it off. Whereas the words agnostic and atheist, most people know what those mean. So then they might even challenge you on it. But secular humanist, they just kind of like, oh.
Yeah. Is that like a leftist thing?
Yeah. Is that like a liberal? Or?
Yeah, that's right. Goddamn libtards.
Yeah. When I was in university, actually, I took a course that was called Moral Education. And before I took that course, I actually thought that I invented the term secular humanist, because I was like, you know, I'm just a good person, you know, I don't need God. I'm good without God. I think people should just live for each other. And I was like, I created this whole ideology. And then I took this class, and then they're like, secular humanism has been around for hundreds of years. I'm like, oh,
I thought I was original.
Yeah, I thought I created my own cult.
Oh, shit. So you went to a Catholic school system?
Yeah, for all of elementary and high school.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's pretty intense. I went to a public school, so I can't really relate.
It's, yeah. You know, I recently found out something interesting about the separate system is that you are technically forced to take these Christian ethics classes, but with a letter from your parents, you are allowed to opt out of them. Now, nobody really knows that because,
right?
of course, the public or the separate schools aren't going to tell you that, because the whole purpose of them is for forced indoctrination along with their studies.
For sure.
But the downside of it is they could, and in the past have, not let that student walk across the stage with their peers to get their diploma. So I feel, how petty is that? That
yeah.
if you're going to not, they're like, you're not going to take our forced education class, then you're not going to get your diploma with your friends. You still get it
yeah.
through the Saskia.
You like, just don't get to stand on stage.
You just don't get to go walk with your friends. Like they take the you know, what's going to hurt them the most. And they
peer
like,
pressure. Yeah. Peer pressure.
Imagine if this was inverted. If the public school said for Christian students that you don't get to go on stage with the rest of your friends to get your diploma if you don't take like an atheism class.
I mean, that
would just cause so much.
Yeah.
Oh.
Like we were talking about tonight, the history of atheism. Yeah. Take that and then you can walk across.
Yeah. People don't understand that, like, indoctrination versus education. You know, we're just, most of us want one school system, which is where we get to the point where we say, yeah, schools are just for education. Everything that we currently know to be true, just get the indoctrination out of it. And a lot of times people that find out I'm an atheist will say, well, you're going to raise your kids to be atheists. You're going to tell them that no God exists, and you're going to tell them that it's all fake. And I back it off, and I say, really, what I want to teach them is critical thinking, creative thinking,
yeah.
how to create your own problems, solve your problems, find the answer. Like, the search for truth is just the most important thing.
And that has been one of the big issues with my family. I mean, my family is fairly religious, but when it comes to, well, how are you going to raise your kids? Well, I don't have any kids yet, but... that's a legitimate concern that they have, because they think now that I'm an atheist, that my kids will be doomed as well to be
to hell.
doomed to hell in this heresy. So, which complicates things somewhat, because once I have kids, will I take them to my grandparents, to their grandparents' house?
My kids. Do stay at their grandparents quite often, like every time I come do the podcast. And my parents are religious, you know, like born again, but then did whatever, and they watch their church on television. But quite often I worry about whether or not they're gonna be like, oh, well, you gotta believe in God to my kids, but I think at this point they know that if they do that, they won't see them very much. So,
yeah, and I think a lot of people can do it very subtly. I mean, most grandparents probably wouldn't yeah. outright tell them, "You little shit, you better start, you know, reading your Bible." But it's the subtle things, you know.
That yeah. depends on the grandparent, really.
Yeah, that's yeah, true.
I guess
it
I guess
can be
you're
more
right.
overt than that.
Yeah. Welcome back, Lana.
Yeah, Lana. Came
I was playing
in.
Cards Against Humanity, and it's really hot in here.
Yeah, it is really hot in here. True. Yeah.
Does anybody else have problems with their grandparents? Like, I had really religious grandparents who then begat my parents, which were sort of weak religious, who now begat us, who are just full-blown atheists.
I'm a generation before that. I have very religious parents. So I, like, but we sort of struck a balance where I let my parents take my kids to church camp every summer. And, you know, I basically have let this happen as long as they're not, you know, really forcing stuff on the kids. I have a lot of faith in my kids' ability to, you know, evaluate information.
Right.
And I'm not trying to keep religion from them. I don't think that they need me to do that. But there has been occasions where they come home from camp and we have some very good discussions and some teachable moments. And so far it's going good. As long as they want to go to camp, then they can go to camp. so it's sort of a compromise that I've struck where, you know, my mom gets to feel like they are getting some level of introduction and indoctrination in religion, where she at least gets her toe in the door. But really, it has not had the desired effect. And, you know, I'm raising some very good skeptical little children that are doing just fine. So it's working okay.
Seems like every time I go out to my farm, which I don't do very much anymore, my grandparents' farm, I always get the, you were baptized, you know?
Did I really have a choice in that?
Yeah. Among other things. And then they always use the word providence. You guys know what providence means? It's like,
it's kind of a fate.
It is, and it's like, it's like when something good happens, they'll say, oh, that was providence, that was God providing for you. And it's like after the fact. And it's like, well, what about when something bad happened? Oh, that wasn't God. You know, but something good, that was God. Mm-hmm. Providence, Dan, that was providence.
What's that Seth Andrews talks about, the God-colored glasses?
Yeah, that's totally what it is.
Everything good is God's
only
deal.
Count the hits, not the misses.
Yeah, that's right.
It doesn't help that my grandma's sister is actually a sister. We call her Sister Bernadine, so she's a nun. And yeah, it's like the clutches. Come back to the faith, Dan. You were baptized. What about your kids? Everything's.
Yeah.
But your brother is an atheist also.
My older brother's an atheist. My little brother, I don't know, would probably call himself an agnostic as well. You can't be friends with me for very long without without having that experience. Even my wife would have considered herself a weak theist when we met her. And now she said tonight, which made me smile, she was like, it's kind of annoying to me when people meet people like us and they think that just because we're non-religious that we're not allowed to have a Christmas tree. And I was like, oh, you're non-religious.
Nice. Because
she doesn't want to admit it because then it means like I'm right. And so it's just like you just can't live with me and have the discussions with me on a regular basis and not sort of just get shifted over slightly in your atheism spectrum.
No, that's pretty good. So you guys do celebrate Christmas then?
Oh yeah, it's been in tradition for both of us. We've always done presents at that time of year. We've always had a tree that time of year. It just, I don't see any reason to change that. We can just take whatever. I think the whole big part about being an atheist is that we now have to create our own meaning in this world. We have to make meaning for ourselves. We have to say, okay, we're doing this because this reason. You're not doing things for a higher purpose or higher power. So we're doing this, and now the focus just has flipped to be totally on our family and our friends and say, this entire season is about spending time with family and friends, getting through the darkest, like, just even talk in terms
literally
of...
darkest.
Literally the darkest time of year, right?
To me, that is the biggest... that is at core the reason for Christmas. It's dark and depressing. It's the longest days of the year. We're trying, you know, boozing our way through the longest days of the year in order to, you know, until the days start getting longer. And then we're like, well, I guess it'll be spring soon.
Yeah.
I keep bragging about how I spent a day the other day getting day drunk just because I took the day off. I was fucking getting drunk by myself and watching The Walking Dead. Everybody goes, Corey, that's not okay.
but having the occasional day like that is like therapy. You
know? Yeah, well, that's just it. Like, it's December. Of course I need that. Yeah, see,
I don't do the day drunk. I do the day sleep where I just do not leave. I do not leave my bed. I wake up and I'm like, going back to sleep for a few hours. And I'm like, how is it 2? I might as well just stay in until 9 again. Yeah,
nice. I've never been able to do it all day, like stay in bed all day.
You gotta have a good wife to bring you the food and drink, man.
Yeah, I don't have that. But with that, I'm not trying to imply that I have a bad wife. I don't have any wife. I have a weekend ritual ever since I stopped going to church several years ago. My Sundays have been wide open to sleep till 12 at least. and I have the ability to actually sleep until my alarm rings at 12 at noon.
See, and if you met a religious person, they would say, you just gave up the faith because you wanted to sleep in on Sundays.
It was just an added perk. You know?
Yeah, you know? That's right.
That's how I look at it, too. Okay, hey, guys, I've been monopolizing your mic long enough here. I'm going to head out and find someone else to come in, okay?
Perfect. All right. Thanks, man.
Nice chatting with you guys, and I'm going to download this one and listen to myself talk.
All right, you should plug the CFI site.
Oh, should I?
Yeah.
All right, sure. I thought you guys did that enough.
I'm terrible for doing, like, recommending people plug their stuff.
Yeah. So. I thought you guys did that enough, but okay, if you live in Regina or area, you should check out the Center for Inquiry. CFICanada.ca is our corporate website, and then you can find us on Facebook as well, just under Center for Inquiry Regina. And on there, we have lots of different debates regarding mostly current events, things that are going on in our city, as well as discussions about ways that we want to shape our city to be more secular, more skeptical, and then invites to all of the events that we host. We have probably an average of about 8 to 10 of them a year. Skeptics in the Pub, we go to coffee shops, we have our Festivus. Coming up in February is Darwin Day. So if you're interested in any of those events, just find us on our page. And then, click that you're attending and, of course, invite all your friends. I hope to see you out there.
And it's also important to note that the CFI group is a closed group. So if you have highly religious friends or relatives, if you join the group, whatever you post inside in that group is private. So
yeah, that's right.
But they can probably still see that you are in the group.
Yeah, they can see that you're part.
I don't think they can.
Unless it's a secret.
But group. But even if they can see that, that's not. But in that group, you can share whatever you want. Without.
Which may be why someone might want to join the Center for Inquiry group versus the Regina Atheist group.
Yes, there is a difference.
I didn't even know that existed.
The Regina Atheist group.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Amber Button, I think, is the one who puts that.
Okay.
Runs that group.
Though that one has been kind of on the down low in the last couple of months.
I said it was that long.
Is that right?
Yeah, because she moved out of town.
Oh, is that right?
She used to live in Regina. Now she lives.
I think down low means something different than what you mentioned it as.
Oh.
Yes, it does. It means something totally different.
But you're not thinking of the dirty down low.
That's exactly
it has a different meaning.
Is there any other kind of down low?
Yeah, it means kind of on the hush, like kind of like not talked about.
On the down low.
Kind of.
No, that's the same down low.
So it's kind of gone.
You all have pretty dirty minds. I'm sorry.
Just gonna listen.
Okay. Yeah, that's fair.
So you just might as well sit. You don't have to say anything.
That's fine.
Yeah. So I guess. Unless somebody else is coming in to chat with us,
I'll go out and see if I can find somebody who wants to.
Sounds good.
To chat or do an interview.
Yeah. Okay. No, that sounds perfect. We're kind of just trolling for guests.
Is this a live stream?
Yes.
Yes, we are live. Why don't you introduce yourself? You can use a
first
pseudonym.
First names is all that name.
You can use a pseudonym.
Well,
we had a really fun round of white elephant gifts.
Yes, that was.
That was pretty fun. There was some good booze getting swapped around.
I gave my number to Leo because I didn't want...
Which he was very insulted about because it was capitalism at Festivus. And Festivus is supposed to be against capitalism.
Yeah, that's
so
right.
The irony of the situation seemed to be overwhelming.
Seemed to be quite a big deal.
All right, so the minute I leave, you start talking about me. I see how this works. Yeah. I see how this works.
Well, technically, we didn't mention you until you came back into the room.
But yeah. So I guess on that point, I did see the irony right as I heard about the white elephant gift that Festivus stands for.
So I wonder who did Dan end up taking home the elephant trunk thong, or did someone else take it?
I'm not sure. We weren't there for the end of it. It seemed to be somewhat of a desired object.
It was still going on when we started the show.
It probably stayed put.
Yeah.
Well. That's what the elephant is for, to help it stay put.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. That's exactly what it's for. Yeah.
Well, I think Angela's coming in a minute or so.
Excellent. No, that's perfect.
So I think she's in the bathroom. I'm not sure if we're supposed to say that on the air.
No.
You may not have wanted to mention that.
I think we could say whatever we want.
Yeah, I guess.
And here's Angela.
We have a revolving door going on.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, not literally.
Yeah, no, that'd be a lot easier.
We mentioned the open door policy for guests and whatnot.
Hopefully I don't get crushed between the door.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Angela.
Hi.
How's it going?
It's going pretty good.
Having a good time out there?
Yeah, we're celebrating Festivus. It's right on. It's pretty great.
So... Eventually, I would like to talk to you about your being a speaker at the conference coming up.
Yes.
But for starters, we'll go with how long have you been involved with the CFI?
Not very long. It's only been since, like, probably July, and that my husband and I kind of came out as skeptics, and we kind of sought skeptical people like us. So it's kind of been not very long, so it's kind of exciting to meet new people.
So it's moved pretty quickly then. Yep. You've met a lot of people.
Yeah.
And
so you said that you came out as skeptics. Were you skeptics for a long time before that, or was that, did you come out right away as you...
Well, we've kind of, as we've talked about, we've kind of always been skeptical, but I think we've kind of just identified more as skeptics and told other people that we're skeptical.
That's
of
awesome.
Things. Yeah.
Yeah, I saw your post not that long ago about to your family and stuff about the atheism and
yes.
Was there much backlash for that?
I did get a lot. Like my father had commented on that exact status.
Is that right?
And he's very, bless his heart, he's a spiritual guy, and he comes from a checkered past, but I mean, and that's kind of sort of what I'll be speaking about in April, but
okay.
he kind of commented kind of like, he always, when I'm skeptical of things, he always wants to say, well, I guess I was a bad dad, you know, I didn't teach you well enough and stuff like that. Geez. So
it's too bad he takes it on himself.
Both my parents do that. But
as a bad thing, even.
It's kind of an emotional blackmail.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is.
It's really aggravating.
Yeah. I don't like it. But I kind of wanted backlash from that status, but I didn't get as much as I wanted. And then subsequently I posted like, I want some real conversations, people. Like, come on, let's have some real conversations. And
people are afraid of it.
I know.
Yeah. They don't like having, you know, mean things going on among family members, particularly on Facebook.
Yeah.
Because it gets, yeah, you know, right. And, you know, I've had a fair few of those sort of things go on, and a lot of people are just like, you know, that this is kind of dirty laundry that they don't want to air, which... You know, in some ways, it's better if it goes on online than in person because, you know, you at least have time to think about things. You're not having this, you know, as much of an emotional reaction to being in the same physical space as someone.
Yeah, you don't.
To me,
you're not automatically attached to that quick reaction thinking.
Yeah.
You can slow down your thinking and go, oh, well, what's the proper response to this?
Yeah. It, whether you do or not, is it a, you know,
that's, yeah, that's the other thing, too.
Exactly. Yeah, whether you actually do. Yeah, that's quite a deal. Yeah.
And I mean, I had kind of a similar experience. I mean, my parents had that same emotional blackness.
Yeah. Is his mic not work? Oh, we're suddenly got a delay.
Yeah, it's got quite a delay, but yeah. So I had the same experience with my parents. They kind of took that same approach, blaming themselves for what was happening. I mean, they're like, you know, were we bad parents? Why why did this happen? Why, you know, should we have taught you better? I mean, what happened? And they were pretty much the only ones. I have most of my extended family is also very religious, but none of them have said a word about it. Like, it's just very passive, non-confrontational, just like, we can't deal with this right now. And even most of my former religious friends, they just couldn't deal with it, just like, oh, you know, we're just going to continue on the same course.
You're gonna assume he's going through a phase.
And not talk about this, because I only had a couple of friends come up to me just like, yeah, so what happened? Yeah. But that was pretty much it. Most of them didn't even want to address the issue.
Do you think it might have been easier if you were family as opposed to an acquaintance or a friend?
Well, even my family didn't address the issue.
No? Yeah.
Okay. See, I had a little bit of a different response where I had a sister and a mom who kind of tried to do an intervention over Christmas during a time while my husband was actually dying. Basically having a spiritual intervention and being very, mostly my sister, being very confrontational.
Wow.
And I basically considered that a massive betrayal of any kind of family honor that should exist.
That's horrible.
Oh, yes. Yeah, and my twin sister, to the point where, you know, we don't really have much of a relationship anymore, which is kind of an overshare here. But, you know, that there are occasions where, you know, people not holding their tongue can have that sort of effect. If they decide that you need to have an intervention,
yeah,
then that can go bad really fast. It's not like you have a drug problem, but it's basically, you know, my sister, I said, I can't have a relationship with someone who thinks that I am actually possessed by, you know, evil spirits of, you know, some sort.
It's a bit of a
That's they think that I have been invaded in some fashion. You can't have a relationship with people who think that you have been that your brain has been invaded by evil spirits and you're no longer a rational, functioning human being.
Mm-hmm. They might not think that your healing has worked properly.
Yeah. While it seems like you would like to have some discussions, you're not always going to have productive discussions.
That's true.
And, you know, and over time they tend to just go, okay, you know, the sky hasn't fallen, they haven't, you know, done horrible things, so I guess, you know, we'll just leave things as they are.
Yeah, I my grandma one time, she sent a bunch of money to my siblings and I, and it was graded on a scale. And the more pious you were, the more money you got.
Whoa.
Wow.
And according to the letter she sent with the checks, she said, "What a great gift it would be to your parents to accept Jesus Christ as your personal savior." And I promptly sent the money back to my grandma, and I said, "Grandma, I'd love to talk to you about this." But she never responded to me.
Yeah.
And my grandma is the kind of person, she loves these big overtures in front of large crowds. saying, you're all going to hell. Just, she doesn't say thanks for coming. She's like, have you converted?
And, oh, geez, eh?
But one-on-one or in letter form, she's just intense.
So, I don't have a mic, and I'm really sorry, but how many people have ever thought it acceptable that they have parents and they would go espousing the beliefs of their parents as thus that their parents hate everything. They hate specific acts and these people acting out specific acts they'll condemn to hell. And then you transfer that belief to
I'm
a
not
god.
Sure if...
And it's acceptable that he will find these beliefs totally...
Here.
You need a
sit,
mic.
Yeah, go. Sit down and have
sorry.
A...
Sorry.
Sit down and have a mic. Where...
you know what? I don't even remember how I began that. I'm sorry. I just... Sorry.
It's okay if you're shy. But we just don't want to have an
unintelligible
question going on.
Okay, wait, so... Okay, so if I fuck this up, can you guys cut it out?
No, it's live.
Oh,
fuck. it's okay. We'll probably be able to hear you.
We fuck things up all the time.
No, you don't.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah,
just,
don't
just
say
sit
your
down.
Name.
You can be anonymous guy in black.
This is anonymous.
Don't bother with the headset. We have a delay. It'll get confusing.
Yeah. Talk into the mic, anonymous guy in black.
Okay, so you guys just kind of start with what you were starting with, or
what?
Don't worry about
you
it.
You had a question about parents.
Oh, jeez. I'm such a burnout, so but you guys just talk and I
okay. Well, we were.
What I was talking
we were
well, I'll say you know, listening to your guys' thing, totally. It's weird, is because like my parents weren't overly religious. My grandparents, on the other hand, they were.
Mm-hmm.
My grandpa was a deacon in the Anglican Church. My grandmother was in the choir, the whole nine yards. They went every Sunday, religiously. That's almost joke intended.
Hence the term.
Yeah, but the weird thing was is it was never really forced on us per se. I mean, yeah, it was confirmed in the church. You know, we'd pop in here or there, but it was never a big deal, which is kind of weird now in hindsight because Grandpa, like I said, he was a deacon in the church. And one of the better stories was we had Jehovah's Witnesses showed up at his house one time. And my grandpa was one of those guys that liked to argue.
Yeah.
And so I guess he brought the Jehovah's in, sat him down. Grandpa grabbed his Bible, had the Jehovah sit with his Bible. And he proceeded to argue with the man.
Wow.
And I guess they never were bothered again with Jehovah's Witnesses. They were off.
My experience, too. Yeah. There was this older lady and a younger man that showed up. And I was like, I just was talking to them out in my porch, basically. And, you know, told them I'm an atheist. And we went into a whole bunch of things and answered a bunch of questions. And, you know, talking. It wasn't being at all mean. I was like, you know, I don't mind if you guys come back. Come back anytime. Never once did they come back. So they don't want to actually be challenged on those things. They want, you know, an uninformed ear to bend.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I've had that two times. And, I've moved a couple times now, so I keep expecting them to show up.
Mm-hmm.
But I haven't had anybody show up yet, so.
Okay.
Maybe they know where you live.
They keep track.
You're in a database.
Yeah, blacklisted.
The only other time that happened to me is I was after a night of heavy drinking. I had a couple Mormons show up at my door, and it was like literally, I was just like, "Okay, guys, you don't want to do this." And he's like, "Well, why not?" And it's like, one, I'm hungover. Two, I'm actually knowledgeable. And three. Yeah, no, just the other two reasons. Enough.
Fuck you guys. That's enough, right?
Yeah. It's enough. I don't need to talk to you anymore.
Yeah, I don't care about your magic underwear. Go away.
Exactly.
Okay, well, let's see. Angela, we were talking to you originally. So you're an atheist.
I am an atheist.
How long have you been that, or how long have you identified that way?
I've identified, it's been, like I said... It's been probably 6 months, but I think I've always been skeptical probably since I remember since I was 12 years old. there's times in my life where I've questioned things and kind of railed against the rules that have been imposed on me, and having, you know, it's been a really gradual process for me until, like, so yeah, it's been about 23 years that I've taken to finally identify as an atheist.
That sounds fairly familiar.
Yeah, it takes a while.
Until I was, you know, almost 30.
It is. It's intense. And my dad grew up in a really strict church, and he was eventually kicked out of it. But then, the Church of God in Christ Mennonite, and he went through a rebellious phase, and he kind of came back to his faith more intensely. And
it's very
so
common.
It is, and my mom.
And they're kind of jerks when they do that. Like, to everyone else.
I think that it might be a case of them really.
I'll ask you to.
Sorry.
Yeah, right in.
No,
don't
just
worry
talk
about
into
the
your mic.
Definitely talk into the mic.
Those people coming back to their religion, you don't think that might be a case of them considering it? Like, hearing different perspectives of it and then really considering it and then considering that they might be wrong, at the same time?
I think, I don't know, specifically for my dad,
yeah.
To me, in my pop psychology, I don't know, like, the way that I think about it, certain things happened, he kind of, you know, 2 beer left in his fridge and mustard, and that was it, and he kind of kneeled down and had this kind of moment where he had to, quote-unquote, give his life back to God. And then 3 days later, he met my mom, and a few months later, he was engaged to be married, and, you know, here we are. Like, it was those kinds of events in his life, and that he attributes to God, but it's coincidence, right?
Might and say, give in to the alcohol and justify?
I don't know. Like, he just believes that much more strongly because he those things happened in such a way that, well,
it's a trope. It's a thing I've seen over and over again.
Yeah.
Where people who go through their little rebellious stage, they're indoctrinated, they go through a rebellious stage, and then they discover that they don't do well on their own, that they need to be part of groupthink.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's how I would put that.
Yeah,
so then
I
they
think
kind
so.
Of go back to the groupthink and
yeah.
say, well, you know, it's okay that I have doubts or whatever. I like being part of the group.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And he, I think, I mean, he was indoctrinated with such a strict place that he grew up. I don't think that he really had a choice.
Mm-hmm.
I think losing his faith would have been way more violent and hard.
Psychologically harmful.
Exactly, than just kind of going back into something slightly more relaxed, but ultimately still the same thing. So,
yeah.
Does that not kind of call back into a large part of what we have to fight is...
Sorry.
Bad mic etiquette.
Does that not call back a large part into what we have to fight these people believing theism as the be all and end all with very little evidence?
I think so.
Yeah,
that's
in a
kind
lot
of the...
it's emotional and community reasons.
It is
a lot
very
of
much,
what
isn't
people
it? Huh?
Believe.
Yeah.
They believe it because they have a support network. They believe
yeah.
it because it,
well, I'd
it's
say
the
because
cost
they have
of
a
not believing
sorry.
It is too high.
Yeah.
Socially.
Yeah, there's a
yeah, that's a better way of putting it.
There's a huge social cost.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. and
depending on what your community is,
yeah.
where you live, what your family is like, it's can be a huge social cost
yeah.
that, you know, I have paid.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Just by
well, it's also
having
a
different worldview.
Yeah.
How, like, when you're raised in that, that's a core part of that identity, that,
yeah.
you know, your cultural identity, your personal identity, and to if you're raised in such a way that it's really hard to shift out of that, and that would be, you know, terrifying to go, oh,
for sure.
I hate being drunk right now, but
that's the whole point of these events.
Yeah.
Well, you guys, I have a hard time believing how you're not
talking me into a corner, but maybe that's just me.
This is what we do.
Yeah. You guys don't believe that if these people are brought up to believe in a certain way, and these religious people who are brought up to believe that, let's just take Harper, about how he believed that a large part of what he did, like climate-wise, wasn't responsible for climate change. So human-directed climate change, like Jesus, I hate being drunk. Sorry.
Yeah, wait. Dead air.
No, it's fine. We can't have too much dead air. It's just
construct.
Yeah. My way through the research. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine.
I know.
Stephen Harper had a few ideas about climate change, and he believed that they were right.
But they were colossally fucking wrong.
Right. The problem with that is that something in his not just his belief system, but is in his cognitive narrative allowed for him to both make it so that he believed he was right and believed that the actions he did were the correct actions for what he did believe was the right thing. That's the problem with so much like cognitive theory, cognitive dissonance theory, is it really goes into a lot of depth in that sense, where you draw from your personal experience, your own beliefs, and
what you're doing is a bad action.
No, absolutely not. That's the thing.
That's fair.
And that's the thing.
I'm willing to believe that the majority of what Harper did was bad because he was incredibly fucking ignorant. And I'm sorry.
Well, but yeah, you need a mic to speak.
Sorry. A large part of the reason why I'm not doing this is because I don't want to speak into a mic. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. If you want to be in this, you got to be on the mic.
All right.
That's the thing.
Otherwise, it kind of defeats the purpose.
Yeah, exactly. All right. Fair enough.
Exactly.
Yes, Harper was ignorant, but he wasn't so ignorant that he didn't know. He was more already dictated by his previously established personal narratives
and able to bend the facts around that
in his own mind. Yes.
Yeah. All right. Fair enough. God, this is just difficult. You guys, sorry. I'll hold it. Sorry.
That's one way to piss off the engineer.
Yeah, we don't. That mic is for talking into, not for anything else. Yeah. So, okay. So, anonymous guy in black. You're an atheist, obviously.
No.
No?
I'm very new into coming to the whole atheist belief.
So, what do you identify as?
My whole belief system is that there's a lot wrong in the world. Sorry. A very large part of my belief system.
Okay.
Is this close enough?
Sorry, Angela.
That's okay. I want to come back for longer another time.
You're one of our candidates for the new podcast member. Yes, so that's right. We might hear lots about and from you in the future.
Yes.
I hope so.
I'll just say this one thing.
Take care, you guys. Have a good night.
I believe the fact that a lot of, at least the U.S. political party system is de facto constitutional and not de rigueur constitutional, as in it is not written into the Constitution how these parties function, but 200-300 years down the line, you have these parties functioning without constitutional input. It allows a lot of the BS to go on, and I don't have the education, I'm sorry, to expound upon that.
Well, let's stick to some more straightforward topics about you, perhaps. Without identifying you, like you said, you don't identify as an atheist. So what is your personal identity?
One of the really, one of the things that I read into that really sticks with me is the whole thing about biohacking. So one of the main experiments that they've done is they've altered their
just
diet.
Just to take a sec, like, but I asked you about, like, we're at Festivus, okay, right? Like, I mean, I don't want to be rude. I'm just asking you, like, what identity do you, like, do you believe in God? Do you believe in spirituality? Do you believe in karma, the universe? What belief system do you identify with?
I identify with a higher power. Unfortunately, I don't want to call it God. I don't want to call it Allah. I don't want to call it anything beyond that. I have a hard time believing that that it's just people living meaningless existences that are ultimately meaningless. And the only thing we can do is just try as hard as we can to etch out something for ourselves.
So in a sense, are you just trying to deal with a kind of nihilism
I have a hard time believing that the majority of people born can be forgotten and left behind so easily. I have a really hard time accepting that. If that makes any sense.
Sorry. All right, sounds like we got to get out of here soon.
They're all gearing up.
Yeah, I was under the impression that we would have more time here, so we'll have to cut it short, I guess, tonight. I'm sorry to our single listener, if we have one. But
sorry, Cory, I totally fucked this up.
Oh, that's fine. That's all right. We'll maybe catch you another time and figure it out.
Do you want me to play all those ads anyway?
Yeah, let's play the ads, finish it up, and call it a night, I guess. I'd also like to tell you about ReasonistProducts.com. T-shirts and hoodies with science, reason, and atheist themes. They've got good prices and offer a buy one, get one free deal with the coupon code BRAINSTORM. For a limited time, they're also offering a free T-shirt to BRAINSTORM listeners. Be the first person to tweet the word BRAINSTORM to them at Reasonist Products with no vowels in the word products. That's at Reasonist, PRDCTS. ReasonistProducts.com.
Looking for something new and exciting, or maybe just a change from the old atheist show format? Cellar Door Skeptics Podcast provides listeners with hours of enjoyment each week on Spreaker and iTunes. Check us out as we talk politics, religion, science, reviews of books and music, along with the occasional interview just for a twist. Join Christopher Tanner and Chris Hanna every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern as they bring fresh content to you. Walk with us through the cellar door as we help you prepare for the revolution. You can find us on Spreaker, iTunes, YouTube, and even on Facebook.
The Brainstorm Podcast presents The Shift to Reason, Saskatchewan's first secular conference. It's happening on April 30th, 2016, and features some great speakers that include Seth Andrews, Nate Phelps, and Lavada Lewenning, along with others. This one-day event in Regina includes lunch and a VIP after-party with the speakers. Tickets are available at shifttoreason.eventbrite.ca and start at $95 for early bird tickets with student pricing and limited VIP tickets. Keep up to date with the conference on our Facebook page, facebook.com/shifttoreason.
We just wanted to say thanks to everyone who listens to us, shares the show, gives us a rating on iTunes or Stitcher, or supports us through Patreon and Gumroad. We don't have a lot of interaction sometimes with our listeners, but what we have had proves that we attract some of the best people around. Smart, kind, and cool. An audience truly worthy of the titles Hardcore and Woo-Free. Thanks for helping us make the world a smarter place.
This is an opinion-based podcast. Each person on the podcast is responsible for their own opinions, and those opinions don't necessarily reflect the views of the rest of the panel. Any guests or anyone associated with the people on the podcast, such as spouses, partners, children, other family members, friends, or employers. No one person speaks for the podcast, with the possible exception of Cory, and he doesn't speak for anyone else on the show. The Brainstorm podcast does not represent the views of our sponsors.